So, coming to the etiological factors, the most common we see are genetic, metabolic, and dietary and anatomic causes. So, in genetic, it's not clearly genetic. When genetic causes depends along with the modified based on the lifestyle, then it all causes the stones. It's not just only genetic causes that are there that causes stones. So, these are hypercalciuria, primary hyperoxaluria, and cystinuria, and some rare heredity causes like distal renal tubular acidosis, Dent disease, Bartter syndrome, and hypocalcemic hypercalciuria. And the most common renal stones are caused because of metabolic abnormalities in children, that is hyponatriuria, hypocitriuria, hypouricosuria, and hypomagnesuria. And the dietary causes are increased sodium intake, decreased water intake, increased oxalate intake. These are the most common causes. These are the most common reasons that causes stones. When it comes to anatomy and PUJO and horseshoe kidney, medullary sponge kidney disease, and calcial diverticula are the anatomic reasons that helps in causing renal stones. These are the other characteristics what we see that causes urolithiasis, that are enzyme disorders, renal tubular syndromes, hypercalcemic states, and all. So this I am not going to discuss. And coming to the pathophysiology, how stone forms, it is supersaturation. Saturation is where once we mix anything solid particle into liquid, once it attains a complete solubility, then it will be called saturation. When it is supersaturation, in the sense it's soluted and it forms the crystals, the rest of crystals is called supersaturation. From this supersaturation, the nucleation upsurges forms, and then crystal formations, and the crystal that are attached to the papillae of the kidney and all that leads to stone formation. So here comes the classification for nephrolithiasis. We divide it as calcium containing stones and non-calcium containing stones. In calcium, the most common will be oxalate followed by phosphate. And in non-calcium, it will be uric acid, struvite, cystine, and miscellaneous stones because of drugs and xanthine stones. So this is the most common stone that is seen in children as well as adults, that is calcium oxalate. The general appearance will be the white, hard, radio-opaque structure, and calcium oxalate usually present in the ureter. That is, it forms in the kidney, but it goes into ureter because these are very small. These not becomes large. And also, the other name will be mulberry stones. This had sharp projections. That's why calcium oxalate stones have more pain than any other stones. And the urine color will be cloudy, cloudy urine. And this also will be having hematuria because of sharp projections. And this is staghorn calculus, what we are seeing. Why we name it as staghorn calculus is because it completely seen in the pelvis as well as calcial system. It looks like a like staghorn, so that's why we call this. And the stone occupy it is a stone occupying renal pelvis and calcis. It's a triple phosphate stone, and it's usually in white in color, which is soft in consistency. This occurs in the with the pre-existing infection. It's most commonly unilateral, but it can also be seen bilateral. And uric acid stones, these are seen in less population. That is 5% of all the renal stones contain uric acid, it is usually associated with hyperuricemia. And the general appearance, it is usually small, yellowish and white. It is radiolucent that cannot be seen in X-ray AUB, but in CT definitely uric acid stones are seen. And normal use, when we suspect uric acid stones, that doesn't mean that uric acid level should be high in serum. It will be usually normal. It's usually associated with Wilson's disease, Fanconi syndrome, and Leish-Nyhan syndrome. So cystine stones usually occur in cystinuria, and it is an autosomal recessive disease. In this, the urine will be in acidic nature. That is, it will be more than 7 point. It will be less than 7. And generally, it will be less than 5.5. The urine pH will be, and it is usually radio-opaque because that contains sulfur, and it is very hard. Usually, it is in hexagonal shape, and which is resistant to fragmentation. Usually associated with the hyperuricemia, hemophilia, and muscular dystrophy. Xanthine stones, these are very rare. Usually smooth with brick red color, which is mainly because of deficiency of xanthine oxidase or xanthine dehydrogenase enzyme. In this plasma, we'll see the plasma levels and urine xanthine levels. Plasma levels of xanthine and urine levels of xanthine. generally it will be having xanthinuria. So, but iatrogenic xanthinuria is also seen in allopurinol therapy, where we'll be giving it for uric acid stones. So next comes the struvite stones. This is a compound of magnesium ammonium phosphate mixed with carbonate. It is usually associated with UTI. Occurs in the presence of ammonia and urea that splitting the organisms. Mostly the protease organisms that causes production of ammonia and leads to formation of struvite stones. These are usually radio-opaque. So the most common clinical feature that we see in children is non-specific abdominal pain. It is generally seen in 50 to 70% of cases. And if child tells when there is pain radiating to testicles, or child is always pulling a testicle without telling something, then we should suspect a stone in PUJ, and that's also causing obstruction. And pain in the inner side of thigh or groin, it should be left lower uretric stone. These are all radiating pains. It's because of genitofemoral nerve that supplies both the groin and thigh, and ilioinguinal nerve that will be coming from up. So that will be the causing pain radiating to the testicles. And the other most common presentation child will be UTI. That will be 8 to 70%. It can be bacteria, pyuria, and just positive culture. It will be like 29, 51, and 27%. These are all literature from Mayo Clinic. And the family history will be present in almost children from 12 to 20, 50%. And microscopic or macroscopic hematuria is seen in almost 90% cases, like 30 to 90% cases. So once we see a stone or we suspect a stone, what is the preliminary evaluation we do? First will be the urine examination. It will shows the characteristic crystals such as supersaturation. I'll be showing you the pictures how the crystal formation will be seen in the urine examination routine analysis. So, and the routine investigations like serum urea, creatinine, calcium, phosphate, sodium, potassium, chloride, and parathyroid hormone levels. And also, if child sometimes passes stones, that should be analyzed. And this is how in urine examination the calcium oxalate stones looks like. In calcium oxalate, it will be two types. One is calcium monohydrate and one is dihydrate. The calcium monohydrate will be looks like an hourglass, or it is also called as dumbbell type. And dihydrate, it will be envelope or tetrahedral. And when it comes to struvite stones, it will be the second picture of how we see. It will be a rectangular stones or coffee-laden appearance, this we call. And when it comes to uric acid stones, this is below the struvite stones. This will be this is like plates or amorphous shades. And cystine stones will be in the hexagonal shape. These are all crystals that we see when do urine microscopy. So metabolic evaluation. So when we do metabolic evaluation should be not done once if any child that comes with a single time episode or stone formation. In all children doesn't require metabolic evaluation. But indications will be the recurrent stone formers, strong family history of stones, any intestinal diseases or previous any intestinal surgeries that intestinal resection was done, pathological skeletal fractures, osteoporosis, history of urinary tract infection with Calliclae, personal history of gout or any solitary kidney, anatomical abnormalities like horseshoe kidney, PUJ or anything, renal insufficiency, stones composed of cystine, uric acid or struvite after stone analysis. If these are there, metabolic evaluation should be done. So coming to stone analysis, the minimal should be done is stone analysis followed by urine analysis, as I said, microscopy and all. Then urine culture to look for urea splitting organisms, that is protease organisms, and spot urine calcium creatinine ratio and 24-hour urine routine. In 24-hour urine routine, the most common we should see is the urine volume, how much amount the child is passing urine. Generally, a child based on the age, he should pass more than 1 ml per kg per hour every day. This is a minimum quantity of urine that child should pass. If it is less, the chance of forming stones will be high. That is why urine volume is important. And pH, the urine pH, if it's more than 7.5, it's called infectious because of infectious lithiasis. When it comes to less than 5.5, that is uric acid stones, mainly because of infection and all, it will be formed. And as I said, we'll be looking for in urine calcium, oxalate, uric acid, cystine, citrate, magnesium, sodium, phosphorus, and potassium. or the urine, what are the levels in this scene. So for collection of 24-hour urine analysis, we should be collecting two separate 24-hour urine analysis samples. It's not just one sample that is enough. So it should be complete 24-hour urine collection. And in this, the creatinine should be greater than 15 to 20 mg per kg. And calcium is in this, if it's normal, the calcium is less than 4 mg per kg per day. In oxalate is less than 0.57 mg per kg per day. In citrate, it should be more than 6 mg per kg per day. Uric acid should be less than 10 mg per kg per day. And urine volume should always be more than 1 ml per kg per hour. These are the basics or the normal values that we should see in a urine analysis. If any abnormality, then we should be following up with other causes that is leading to this. So what is Bowen risk index? This is mainly used to classify or risk stratify the calcium oxalate stones. This BRA calculation is done from 24-hour urine sample. In this, the ratio of calcium in millimoles per liter and oxalate in millimoles per liter is added to 200 ml sample of crystallization. This, in adults, it will be more than 1 liter. But in pediatrics, generally it should be less than 0.05. But if it's more than 4, it will be called as chances of forming calcium oxalate stones will be high in children. So the next investigation after urine analysis will be imaging. That the first and basic investigation that we get is ultrasound. And in this, the most advantage will be more sensitive modality of detection of calculi. And it also detects urine, or not only renal calculi, ureteric calculi and bateral calculi. It is easily available. In this, the ultrasound appearance, how renal calculi shows is, it shows the acoustic shadow. Once the rays passes, then the below will be the acoustic shadow, and that means there is a stone above it. So we can clearly say, and not small, some small stones can be missed, and it's almost always operator dependent. So ultrasound is not a gold standard for renal stones, but is a basic modality of renal stones. If we have a best ultrasound, then there is no need for other investigations. So next comes X-ray KUB. In this, we'll be seeing as radio opaque and radiolucent stones that are calcium oxalate, phosphate, struvite and cystine stones that will be radio opaque, whereas radiolucent will be uric acid, triamethrin and silica and xanthin stones are radiolucent stones. So next, the most and gold standard investigation for uric renal stones will be CTKUB. In CTKUB, generally what we use is plain CT, in which contrast is not at all given. We can identify the location of stone, as well as in recent things there is called MDCT, that is MDCT and dual energy CT. Dual energy CT is mainly for pre-treatment characterization of stone composition. This is mainly based on Hausfeld units. Based on Hausfeld units, they'll be defining whether it is calcium oxalate, calcium phosphate, or uric acid or cystine stones based on the Hausfeld units. So this is how CTKUB used, and also to determine the modality of treatment and the size of stone. So when a child comes to ER with pain abdomen or any symptoms of renal calculi, the most and foremost thing we should do is will be pain management followed by IV hydration of the patient. And once this survey is done, we should be evaluating the child. And if the pain subsides and all, then we should be managing it conservatively. And if sometimes ureteric stones will be there, then we'll be using expulsive therapy. All urologists are not using expulsive therapy, but some urologists still prefer expulsive therapy will be the best for ureteric stones. That is tamsulosin. Generally, the dose will be 0.02 mg per kg per day. So next, when it comes to surgical management, we'll be discussing about the different surgical modalities, and most common and gold standard technique is PCNL. So we'll be coming to the indications, that is any renal stone that is more than 2 cm, Staghorn calculi, lower pole stones with more than 1 cm, when extracorporeal shockwave lithotripsy is failed, and stones associated with obstruction, and when there is abnormal anatomy, that is like horseshoe kidney, calcial diverticulum and kyphoscoliosis, PCNL will be the indications, because ESWL will not be possible in these conditions. And coming to the aims, what will be our main aim in doing PCNL? It should be a complete stone clearance. If complete stone clearance is not possible, we should be clearing the renal pelvis to improve the drainage and clear the lower pole calluses, as they may not be responding to the shockwave lithotripsy. And the residual stones in upper and interpolar region can be treated with shockwave lithotripsy. So the first I'll be just explaining the procedure, followed by showing a video. So first, the procedure will be done with patient in supine position, followed by cystoscopy, followed which ureteric catheterization will be done. And after that, patient will be turned into prone position with all preventing tube blockage and all. After that, percutaneous renal access is attained, followed which tract dilatation is done, followed which fragmentation of stones will be done and extraction of stone, followed by wound dressing. So once the patient is turned into prone position, we'll be passing a CM over the patient. First it will be the I'll be just explaining the patient in procedure and followed by showing a video. Once the CM should be in 90 degrees to the patient, and once the CM is in 90 degrees to the patient, we'll be assessing what is the calyx we are going to puncture. That will be a point called calcial point, that will be a point called A. Then this will be in the 90 degrees. Then the CM will be turned slightly 30 degrees, so that we'll be seeing a point, we'll be seeing it from the 30 degrees angle, which is the least and the shortest point we can be achieving for puncture of calyx. In this, generally the kidney will be the most, in this there is a mnemonic to remember each, that is LAMP. The LAMP, in the sense, in kidney generally it will be the lateral and medial calyx. But when it comes to a PCNL, we should be turning it into the medial and anterior and posterior calyx. So in LAMP, the L is lateral. Lateral resembles anterior and medial resembles posterior. This is how we differentiate the calyx in the kidney. So once we attain the once we see in a CM that the calyx is seen, so the main target is to hit the posterior calyx. So this is how the marking is done. A will be the horizontal marking, B will be the 30 degrees marking, and B1 will be the point of insertion of a needle where we will hit the calyx. So one second, sir.
In the treat position. For the patient.
So if you see, this is how the horizontal marking should be done. This is a point A. That means the kidney, when it is anteroposterior, we are marking it as a A point. So, and after that, again, we'll be turning into the 30 degrees laterally, so that we'll be getting a point B. That means, so we are turning a position so that we are inserting a needle into the calyx what we want to target. So this, if you see, this is a posterior calyx. That means this is a medial calyx, that is initially. So once we turn it into the laterally, then this will be the posterior calyx what we are seeing. So the hit should be like, this is the A point, that is lateral calyx, and this is the B point. If we see this triangle, we are seeing a point, the tip of triangle. So this is where the needle is getting inserted. And this is how we'll be getting an access to the posterior calyx. This is called triangulation technique.
रोहित हेलो रोहित
सर सर
ओके यू आर स्टॉप्ड
या सॉरी सर वी कुडंट या सॉरी
सॉरी सर वी कुडंट या नहीं सर गो अहेड यू कैन
of the operative technique. The operation begins with a standard puncture under fluoroscopy or sonography guidance. A 4 mm incision is placed in the loin with the patient in the prone position. The desired operative technique. Operation begins.
Sir, this is what I am telling. This will be the point of entry. So this these markings and all we did what I showed you in the before video, and this is how we'll be entering the pelvic calcium system. And the most desired area of entry will be the lower calyx, with lower pole posterior calyx will be the most desired point for the entry. So this is how the needle is injected into the skin, followed by the calyx, followed which will be passing a guide wire on which. Sir, you are able to hear?
Yeah, we could hear you. Go ahead.
Sure. So sure. Followed which we'll be dilating the tracks with the dilators. The generally routine nephroscope what we use will be the 14 French nephroscope. So until which the dilator should be passed and it should be dilated. So once everything was dilated, then the sheet first sheet will be passed, and followed which over the sheet nephroscope will be passed. This is what the sheet that they are passing it. After this, we'll be removing the cannula, and followed which nephroscope is introduced to it to confirm whether these are in positions. Before doing all this, we'll be dilating the calyceal system using a dye. Based on that, we can see the dye in the fluoroscope, through which once we pass the nephroscope, this is how the sheet will be. Through this sheet, we'll be passing the nephroscope. So this is the nephroscope, and this will be having the irrigation channel as well as the working channel. And working channel in the sense, whether lithotripter or we'll be using the laser, it depends on our institute. So once nephroscope was passed, we could see how after entering into the pelvic calcium system, we could see the ureteric stent that we placed previously, and this is where the stone is. And we could see the upper calyx. Once we enter into the calcium system, we will be seeing the upper calyx, lower calyx and all, and fragmentation will be done. Here they are using holmium laser, but in our institute we will be using pneumatic lithotripter for fragmentation. So once this is come, the stones will be removed through a thing called whirlpool technique. That is how the breakage or fragment of stones comes out from the ureteric or nephroscope. So this is how they are generally. This is how generally they are used. First ureteric catheterization, prone oblique position, renal axis, and renal axis. The safest point for calcial puncture is through Bordel's line, that is between anterior and posterior divisions of renal artery. Why this is mainly because the posterior branch injury is most common when we hitting through the upper pole calyx. That cause, because renal arteries are end arteries, the chances of renal artery damage, we could control the bleed and all through CT angio and all, I mean angiography and all, but damage to the kidney will be more. That's why PCNL is not cannot be done by everyone. It's a steep learning curve, and the most renal axis should be the lower pulp and the posterior calyx. So this is how we'll be assessing upper pole calyx and lower pole calyx. In lower pole calyx, what we can clear will be the lower pole we can clear, pelvis we can clear, upper pole can be cleared, and interpolar can be amenable. But when it comes to the upper pole, when we access the upper pole, only upper pole, pelvis, PUJO, lower pole, and upper ureter can be cleared. This upper pole is doing will be easy, but accessing will be difficult. But when it comes to lower pole, accessing will be slightly easy, and going through all calyceal systems will be slightly difficult. And the advantages are the like same. It will be safe, and posterior lateral punctures will be avoided, and hemorrhage can be controlled because it will be from the avascular plane and it has a good visibility. But whereas upper pole, it is better in patients with obese and good access to the pelvis, because it has good access to the pelvis, PUJ, and also the complex lower poles can be accessed. Whereas disadvantage with lower pole will be it will be lying parallel to the lower pole calyx, which we cannot access. If we access the lower pole, and PUJO cannot be accessed. When it comes to the upper pole, the injury to the posterior segmental artery will be more, and also intercostal punctures and pleura and parenchymal damage will be more, which will be causing more morbidity. So, and the other things in PCNL will be mini PCNL and tubeless PCNL. Mini PCNL will be using a smaller tracks with the sheets from 16 to 24 French sheets, and it also the process and everything will be the same, but it just reduces the morbidity, and there will be no change in complications when it compared to a normal PCNL. It is mainly suitable in children. That's what now we are all going through mini PCNL, and the tubeless PCNL is in the sense. In uncomplicated cases and all, there is no. Once we place the urethric catheter alone is enough. There is no covering need for nephrostomy tube post PCNL. The indications for this will be a smaller stone burden, single puncture, no distal obstruction, no significant bleeding, no collecting system perforation, or no requirement for second PCNL. So the complications for PCNL will be in intraop. It will be bleeding, loss of access, pelvic perforation, abdominal organ injury, pneumothorax, hydrothorax, equipment malfunction, and instrument breakage. And in early post-operative period, it will be sepsis, pyrexia, bleeding, leaking from the misplaced nephrostomy tube, and retained stone and perinephric collection. And in a late post-operative period, it will be infundibular stenosis because from the large stone, long post-operative time, and multiple subsequent procedures, and prolonged nephrostomy tube drainage will call infundibular stenosis, and also AV fistula, and also and sometimes retained stone can be also the late postoperative complication. So this comes to an end for renal stones. I'll be discussing shockwave lithotripsy later. And when it comes to uretric calculi, the most common technique we use will be ureteroscopic retrieval, or ureteroscopic derma basket, or laser or lithotripter. The indications will be shockwave lithotripsy failure, impacted stones, multiple stones, and or large stones more than 10 mm. In children, if it's more than 7 mm, we can consider for ureteroscope, and in some children we can go until 10 mm, because mostly they'll be impacted at VUJ. And by expulsive therapy, it can be coming out. And when it comes to distal obstruction, or when it's a solitary kidney, better to do ureteroscope early than conservative management. So when it comes to procedure, the most common position we'll keeping will be Lord Davis extended lithotomy position, followed with cystoscopy will be done, and insertion of safety guide wire, and then uretric catheterization will be done, and retrograde uretropyelography will be done in some cases. Not all cases requires retrograde pyelography. Intubation of ureter with ureteroscope and stone access should be done, and then stone fragmentation will be done and retrieval, followed which digestant insertion or without digestant insertion is optional. And bladder drainage by placing a catheter or not, also it's optional based on the surgeon. So we'll be seeing how ureteric stones generally will be, they'll be removing it. So once cystoscope is passed, then guide wire will be passed through the ureter, and once this is a balloon that is passing across the stone. Why this balloon was deflated and it's came across, why can't we directly go and fragment, is because once we fragment, sometimes stones may go into the renal pelvis also. That's why we'll be just preventing as a stop where the stones cannot go up. Here they are using laser as lithotripter, but as I said, in our institute it's only pneumatic lithotripter. We can also use Dorima basket. Dormia basket. So these are the other lithotrips we can do. One is ultrasound, electrohydraulic, laser or plastic like lithoclast. And the advantages with ultrasound will be able to aspirate the fragments, and but is not suitable for with ureteroscopy. Electrohydraulic will be good fragmentation will be done, like it will be very small, it will be less than 2 mm, or it can be done as a sand particles, but it can damage urothelium and it is difficult to control. Whereas laser, it is flexible, like we can all fibers cannot be rotated in all directions, but whereas laser fibers can be rotated in all directions, and minimal propulsion will be there, and disadvantage will be more expensive, and these are more fragile fibers. And whereas when it comes to plastic or lithoplast, it is easy to use and inexpensive, but the propulsion of fragments it cannot be break all stones sometimes. So, and one more is, as I said, Dorima basket and tri-radiate forceps. We can attain a quick clearance, and sometimes it can become impacted with the Dorima basket, whereas tri-radiate forceps, it will be slow and it will procedure time will be long. Sometimes it can become entrapped. We cannot remove the stone. When it comes to shockwave lithotripsy, it's extracorporeal shockwave lithotripsy what we use, and more than 75% to 90% have stone free rates at 3 months with stones up to 2.5 centimeters. Children can pass large stone fragments than adults. In shockwave lithotripsy, in early in 1980, first it was reported in adults, followed by children in 1986. It is a primary treatment for upper urinary tract calculi and has efficacy ranging from 68% to 84%. In shockwave lithotripsy, it is preferred in modality like uncomplicated renal stones and proximal renal calculi of less than 2 cm, like 15 mm or smaller in pediatric patients. The complications will be hematuria, ecchymosis to obstruction and sepsis, because the fragments will be still in the renal calcium system. So in children, shockwave lithotripsy is also done under general anesthesia, because they will be continuously moving and it will be directed at a single point. So it will be done under general anesthesia. The current recommendation will be low power setting to prevent stone migration with the shockwaves per session will be less than 2000 to 3000, from between less than 2000. In generally in literature, they had given from 800 to 3000 shockwaves per session. This is how shockwave lithotripsy machine will be looking like, and they'll be passing the shockwaves through the stone under the fluoroscopic guidance, and this will be left in the same place for a selected period of time based on the stone fragments that are seen. This will be not be done in a single session, it can be done in a multiple sessions. So the relative indications for Shotwell lithotripsy is solitary kidney, Staghorn calculi, and large uretral calculi, obstruction or abnormal anatomy. And relative contraindications will be marked obesity, large stone burden, increased stone density, congenital skeletal or renal abnormalities, or any previously failed Shotwell lithotripsy. The most common type of stone upper urinary tract in children will be the calcium oxalate. But in calcium oxalate, monohydrate will be easily fragmentable with Shotwell lithotripsy, and dihydrate is not fragmentable with Shotwell lithotripsy. And the recent and is retrograde intrarenal surgery, that is RIRS. In this endoscopic surgery formed, this is endoscopic surgery performed to remove renal stones by reaching the kidney from the ureter. That is, like a cystoscopy, we'll passing it through the urethra, and then we'll be entering the required ureter, followed which we'll be entering the renal pelvis. In this RIRS clears renal stones through flexible uretrorenoscope and the lithotripters, including holmium laser, ensuring that no trace of stones are left. It is a prime method of treatment of renal stones when it is only less than 2 cm and can be successfully treated via other methods also. The best suited cases for RIRS will be earlier attempts to remove renal stones that have failed and stones that are larger in size that are not amenable for other procedures. Whether if there is any tumor in the kidney, mostly renal stones in children, when there are bleeding disorders where Shotwell lithotripsy cannot be used or PCNL cannot be used, obese patients, complex anatomical kidneys, and when there are anticoagulants. So advantage will be this is minimally invasive, simpler and quicker procedure, shorter recovery time, less painful, less morbidity and minimal bleeding, and no risk to the renal tissue, and very fewer complications compared to PCNL or ESWL. This is the same like ureteroscope, how we pass through the urethra, and from urethra we'll be entering from bladder we'll be entering the targeted site, and from ureter we'll be reaching until the kidney, where we'll be blasting the stones with the laser or lithotripter what we have. So in this state, the most stone belt will be seen in northwestern Karnataka. When it comes to India, the most stone belt will be in the northeastern states as well as the southwestern states, that is northwestern Karnataka, south coastal Maharashtra and Goa. This has a more prevalence for stones. And coming to the prevention of stone disease, the most basic thing will be increase water intake and make sure that child is passing more than 1 ml per kg per day, and decrease the sodium intake. That's recommended will be less than 2 grams per day, recommended less than 2 grams will be enough, and not to take any salt in a diet, and also decrease the calcium oxalate intake by reducing the green leafy vegetables, potatoes and tomatoes. Thank you, sir. Sir, sir,
this meeting end.
Jada, sir. Ram sir,
meeting is going to end now.
No sir.
Still more time is there.
Still more time is there, sir.
Okay. No, you told you could use lithotripter for RIRS. It is not possible to use lithotripter for RIRS.
Holmium laser for RIRS.
Only laser can be used for RIRS. All right.
Yes sir.
And the paper you have to read is not the Mayo Clinic paper,
Sir.
more of our Indian papers and this there is one institute called as the Sindh Institute of Urology in Karachi, Pakistan. So they have brought out a lot of articles on pediatric stone disease.
Sir. सर ज्यादा सर
हेलो
हाँ यस सर
क्या रोहित क्या सी सच में बिग टॉपिक तो डेफिनेटली रिक्वायर्स वन और टू सेशंस बिफोर वी स्पीक अबाउट द होल गैमट ऑफ रीनल कैलकुलाई बट एनीवे यू हैव कवर्ड ऑल द टॉपिक्स ऑल द पर्टिनेंट सब टॉपिक्स ऑफ द डिसीज रामचंद्र सर इज देयर
यस सर
Ramchandra sir,
hey, I'm here.
Yeah, do you want to say anything, sir?
No, I just told him that we have to look at more papers from our own studies, like what is done in Nadiad in I think it's Nadiad, no, in Gujarat, where a lot of stonework is being done.
Yes, sir. Nadiad.
And also there is one institute called the Sindh Institute of Urology. At Karachi,
okay,
Sindh Institute of Urology, where the pediatric urology unit for them 60% of their work is stone work.
Oh, okay, sir.
So those are the papers you must read and find out what they are doing. This, you know, what are the indications? What they are doing? What is the stone pattern and all that?
Okay, sir.
That's what I put. Okay, thank you.
But sir, there is one adult urologist who come to our institution to help us with the PCNL, sir. And
yeah.
So the person who is, they say that the urologist itself have divided themselves. Hello?
Yeah, go ahead, Vinay.
Yes, sir. Sir, he was telling that few of the adult urologists have given up on PCNL because of the complications of PCNL. That means
even in adults, they are not doing it.
Yes, sir. Because they think that this is risky to puncture the kidney and the problems associated with the puncture.
Okay.
So they have moved on. People who are doing RIRS. With the gadgetry and then some investment, they are more comfortable in RIRS because the complication rates are less.
Okay.
Whereas PCNL has more complications. And there is one more paper which in urology which comes up from US, which state that the adult urologist in US practices, only 12% do their own punctures, etc. The rest call an intervention radiologist. The intervention radiologist either on CM or on ultrasound will puncture the calyx, and then from there on the urologist will continue the stone work.
Okay.
So only 12% of the adult urologists are puncturing the kidneys.
Okay. I think mainly for litigation and all that.
Yes, sir. Exactly.
Yeah.
And then as Rohit was mentioning, because of the end arteries. Once damaged, you can control the vessel, but that part of the kidney is almost gone.
Yeah, out of correct, correct. Correct.
So, 6 centimeter stone would have resulted in partial nephrectomy or 1/3 or 20% of the kidney is gone.
Yeah.
So, in order to prevent this, they are more and more using intervention radiologists to puncture the kidneys.
Correct, correct.
Other than that, the RIRS, if they have the instrument, if the urologist has purchased the instrument, which is slightly more expensive, then they, some of the people in Bangalore itself are trying RIRS. But the only problem with RIRS in children is there is a sheath which runs from the urethra up to the stone. So on the sheath, the work occurs. So that sheath
correct, correct.
Will be traumatizing the whole. GU systems.
Correct, correct.
So
now they also have single-use flexi-urethroscopes they have.
Yes, sir.
They are supposed to be better. Boston Scientific and all are making this single use flexi reproscope.
Yes, sir.
And many true. Pediatric urologists prefer that, especially in the US.
True, sir.
Only thing is the lower pole calyx is difficult to approach with the RIRS. That's the problem.
Now it will be slightly difficult, sir.
Yeah.
So is there anything that you want to add, sir?
No, no. I just wanted to tell him that we have to concentrate more on our work because we do more stone work in Asia and, you know, especially in adults. So I think in pediatrics also they will have good experience in centers like Nadiad and maybe in Jodhpur and Jaipur and all, they will have very good experience with stone work. And I remember reading some time back this paper from Sindh Institute of Urology, where as I was telling you, the incidence of stone disease is 60% in their practice, in pediatric practice. It's a huge burden. Stone disease is a huge burden for them.
Okay, yes, sir.
I think that author's name was some Sajid or something, Sajid or Rijvi or something from Karachi.
Okay, we will try getting the paper, sir.
Yeah. Sure, sure.
Okay, sir. I'll just search for it.
Okay. Okay, right.
Thank you, sir.
If I find it, I will forward it.
Sure, sir.
Sure, sir. Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir.